Thank you much. Thank you very much for the invitation. It's really a great pleasure to be here and to give a talk to this conference. So I'll speak about real relative invariance and the refinement, and probably making a reference to Laurent's lectures on Monday. Should say that this topic seems to be really a unifying theme in geometry, because it provides some links between the study of continuous quantities and discrete quantities, between analysis and some hidden algebraic structures. So since it's a unifying topic, there are many possible entrances to this topic, and I have chosen tropical entrance. So the plan will be as follows. I will speak first about some tropical invariant problems, and then I will discuss Grigsch and Michalkin's refinement of integration of real rational curves, and then if I have time, and I hope I have time at the end, I will discuss our joint work with Zhenya Shustin concerning refinement in the case of real elliptic curves. So it will be some kind of extension to the elliptic case of Grigsch's approach for refinement of real rational curves. So let's start with some tropical considerations. We'll consider the tropical semi-field, I will denote it T. So as I said, just union of R with minus infinity. So it's R complete with minus infinity and tropical operations as usual. So the tropical addition is the operation of taking maximum, and tropical multiplication is just the ordinary addition. And so if we consider tropical polynomials, so we consider this tropical operation, that's what we consider tropical polynomials. So rather tropical polynomial functions. So the tropical polynomial function is such a piecewise linear convex function, which is a maximum of a finite collection of affine linear functions. And for such a function, we can consider its corner locus. And this corner locus provides us the notion of tropical zeros of a tropical polynomial. And so we'll consider tropical curves. So my drawings will be in R2, and R2 here should be considered as T star squared. So minus infinity plays the role of zero, a natural element for addition in the tropical world. And so when I remove minus infinity, so I keep just R, so I'm T star. So we're considering T star squared as tropical torus. So my drawings will be, my tropical curves will live in R2, but in fact, we should think about some quantification of R2. So we can consider any tropical toric surface, but for the purposes of this talk, let's stick to the case of the projective plane. So my quantification will be, so I will quantify R2 to the tropical projective plane. So you should think about this triangle. So one vertical side, one horizontal side, and one side of slope minus one. And the interior of this triangle is identified with R2. Accordingly, the tropical curves I will consider, they will go to infinity only in three possible directions, either to so each ray going to infinity goes either to the west or to the south or to northeast. So in degree one, we'll have such a simple picture. In degree two, we can have several pictures. So this is not a complete list. And the degree two is an occasion to note that, in fact, each tropical curve, each plane tropical curve, comes together with the dual subdivision of its Newton polygon. So in our case, the Newton polygon is a standard triangle. And each tropical curve we'll consider comes with some subdivision of this triangle. Accordingly, each edge of a tropical curve, in fact, gets a positive integer weight, which is the length of the dual segment in the subdivision, integer length of the dual segment. So, in particular, in my example, there are several edges of weight one. So, the convention will be that I don't indicate the weights equal to one, I indicate only the weights greater than one. So, in my example, there is one edge going to infinity in this west direction. This edge is of either of oh, what did I do? Okay. Is of weight two. This is the integer length of the vertical side of the dual triangle. So, well, I will not continue very long with this sequence of degrees, but this is the last couple of examples in degree three, because it's so what I'd like to say about this example is that there is a natural notion of genus for tropical curves. And so if we consider this plane tropical curves, we can define for each of them genus. And you should think about this genus as the minimal first Betti number of a parameterizing finite graph. And so for the cubic on the left, the genus is zero, it's a rational cubic, because you can parameterize this cubic by finite t. And this green point, which looks like a vertex of our tropical curve, in fact, you can think about this point as intersection of images of two edges of the parameterizing tree. And the cubic on the right is elliptic, the genus is equal to one. So to summarize, you can think about the tropical curves in the plane as graphs. So these are finite rectilinear graphs. So each edge is of rational slope and is equipped with positive integer weight. And there is some balancing condition at the vertices. So at each vertex, the sum of primitive integer vectors of the edges multiplied by the corresponding weights is equal to zero. And so the correspondence theorem proved by Grish and Halton probably in 2002 is the following statement. So we consider, so we fix two integers d and g, so d is the degree and g is the genus. And in our tropical torus in R2, we fix 3d minus 1 plus g points in general position. And we're interested in tropical curves of degree d and genus g passing through this point. When I say genus g, so I will suppose that my curves are irreducible. So that's irreducible curves of genus g. So irreducible tropical rule means that I cannot represent my curve as union of two tropical subcurves. Each of it, this curve being smaller than micro. So I'm interested in these tropical curves of degree d and genus g passing through my points. And I enumerate these curves with certain multiplicities. So I will introduce these multiplicities in a moment. These multiplicities will be extremely important for us. But the statement of the correspondent theorem proved by Grisha is that the number of tropical curves counted with appropriate multiplicities is equal to the corresponding Gromov-Witten invariant of P2. So it's equal to the number of complex curves of degree d and genus g, which pass through 3d minus 1 plus g points in general position in P2. And since, in fact, this correspondent theorem is not just a statement about numbers, it's a statement about some bijection. There is a real version of this theorem. In fact, this real version is incorporated Grisha's corresponding theorem. This real version said that if you're interested in number of real solutions of your enumerative problems, so you are trying to enumerate not complex curves, but real curves, you can do it provided that you enumerate curves with appropriate signs and you do it close to the tropical limit. And in the tropical world, what you are doing, you just can consider your tropical curves, but with another set of multiplicities. And if you do it, you obtain this numbers, I denote by WDG. So these numbers are invariants in the tropical world. And sometimes you get an invariant even far from the tropical limit. In the case when the genus is zero, when we are enumerating rational curves, in this case, what you obtain in this tropical population, you obtain the corresponding Melchiorian value. So now, what are the multiplicities? So let's define the multiplicities, the appropriate multiplicities of tropical curves. So consider a trivalent vertex of a tropical curve. So you can associate to this trivalent vertex a positive integer in the following way. So you take two of three adjacent edges. For each edge, you take the primitive integer vector going from our vertex along the edge, and you multiply this vector by the weight of the edge. So you get a vector in the direction of the edge. So you have two edges, so you cook up the parallelogram out of the two vectors you got. So the Euclidean area of this parallelogram is the multiplicity I'd like to associate to my vectors. Another dual way to say the same thing, if you use the notion of the dual subdivision, in the dual subdivision, our vertex is dual to a triangle, and I just consider the latest area of this triangle. In fact, the balancing condition implies that the description I gave in terms of adjacent edges, in fact, is independent of the choice of two out of three edges. And as I said, it gives the latest area of the dual triangle. So now I'd like to associate a multiplicity to each tropical curve passing through the points I have chosen. So the first claim is that kind of generic statement, but if my points are in general position, then each tropical curve we get in our collection is nodal. So this nodality condition in the tropical world means that each vertex of this curve is either trivalent or four-valent, but in this case, it looks like occasional intersection of two edges of parametrizing graphs, like cross. And I'm not interested in this occasional intersections. So the true vertices are trivalent vertices, for such a nodal curve. And so to each trivalent vertex, we already associated a positive integer. So the multiplicity one should use in Grisha's correspondence theorem is just the product of this multiplicities of trivalent vertices. So you take the product over all trivalent vertices of our curve. So you get a positive integer. This is a multiplicity you use for your tropical curve. So coming back to the statement. So if you use this multiplicity, then you get this correspondence theorem statement. So as I said, you can use another set of multiplicities to enumerate real curves. So the next choice of multiplicities is what I denoted with index W. So W is for Gershon-Weyl. And so if you're interested in real curves, you can use the following multiplicities. So for each tropical curve in our collection, I associate either zero. This is the case if at least one of multiplicities of vertices is even when the tropical curve is killed, it's out of consideration, the multiplicity is zero. Otherwise, so if all the covariant vertices have odd multiplicities, then I take this strange product again over all covariant vertices of my tropical curve. I take minus one to this number, the multiplicity minus one over two. So this Ville-Changer multiplicity of a tropical curve under consideration is either zero or one or minus one. So once again, if we count our tropical curves with these multiplicities, with this Ville-Changer multiplicities, we get the numbers WDG, in particular, if G is equal to zero, we get the corresponding Ville-Changer. And there is the third choice of multiplicities, and that, so this is, in a sense, the subject of this talk. So this choice of multiplicities was suggested by Florian Bloch and Lothar Goetsche. So they suggested to enumerate tropical curves using this multiplicity, I don't know, this index BG. And this multiplicity depends on this parameter Q. So you can do this enumeration of tropical curves with this strange multiplicity. And it's easy to see that at the end, so if you just consider this quantity, so once again, this product over all trivalent vertices, and for each trivalent vertex, I consider this kind of Q analog of the multiplicity of the vertex. So for each tropical curve under consideration, I consider this product, and then I sum up over all tropical curves appearing in my collection. So I will get this symmetric Laurent polynomial in one variable. If I plug one to this Laurent polynomial, I will get back the corresponding Gram-Friedman invariant. And if I plug minus one, I get the corresponding Ville-Changer number. So we get a one parameter family interpolating between Gram-Friedman invariant and Ville-Changer type invariants. So some examples. If the degree is three, so we are enumerating qubits and the genus is zero, we are enumerating rational qubits. This Bloch-Goetsche polynomial is q to minus one plus 10 plus q. If you plug q equal to one, you get 12 qubits. So you get the answer 12. And if you plug q equal to minus one, you get the corresponding Ville-Changer invariant, which is k. So a natural question well, there are several natural questions here, but one of them is what should be meaning, I don't know, algebra geometric meaning or some other meaning of the coefficients of this polynomial. So the sum is the corresponding Gram-Friedman invariant. The alternating sum is the corresponding Ville-Changer number. But what are meanings of some other values, what are meaning of the coefficients? And several suggestions for some algebra geometric interpretations of this Bloch-Goetsche polynomials. So several attempts made, first of all, by Goetsche and Schander, suggested a conjectural interpretation in terms of so-called refined severity degrees, refined considering Herzebruch genera of some relative Hilbert schemes of points. There weren't attempts made by Niquez, Payne, and Schroeter, also was a work by Yuri Gusov. So there were several attempts in various directions. I would like to discuss today the interpretation suggested by Grisha Michalkin. Probably this is the most geometric suggestion among all the suggestions made up to now. But to formulate Grisha's refinement, I will have to modify slightly the enumerative problem. So you will see a little bit later why such modification is. Yes, question?
In particular, one minus one root of purity, do we have an interpretation as a root of purity?
I should probably repeat. So the question is whether do we have interpretation of values at other roots of unity. So I don't know it. So one can imagine some interpretations, but I don't know any convincing interpretation, let's say. But it's of course a very natural question, I agree. So let me slightly modify the enumerative problem. So you will see it's just to adapt my problem to the further considerations. So I plan this talk to be as informal as possible for a Zoom talk. So don't hesitate to ask questions. And that's, by the way, I have chosen this handwritings and not typing of the text, just to try to keep this informal. So let me informally describe the change of my narrative problem. So let me first do it in the rational case. So now what I'd like to do, I'd like to push all these mapped points, so all the chosen points in R2, I'd like to push them to infinity. So in the tropical world, it means that I push them to the boundary of my triangle. In the complex setting, I push my points to the toric divisors. So, in my example, so this is an example of a cubic. So I had 8 points because it's 3D minus 1 plus G. G is equal to 0, D is equal to 3. So we have 8 points in R2. When I pushed them to infinity, suddenly I have 9. So why? Okay, so first of all, of course, I push my points to infinity in a reasonable way. So if the degree is, say, 3, and I push 4 points to the same line at infinity, my solutions will degenerate. That's what I don't want. So I push my points in such a way that at each of 3 coordinate axes in my projective plane, I have at most d points. D the degree. But this means, since I have 3D minus 1 points, this means that I have D points on one axis, D points on the second axis, and D minus 1 points on the third axis. The situation is not symmetric, but it's not a problem because, in fact, all curves of degree D passing through this 3D minus 1 points pass through some extra point on the third axis, kind of Minimal's type statement or Viet type statement. So this 3D minus 1 point determine the last point to fix. So we can think that we fixed 3D points on the coordinate axis, so D points per axis, and these points are in general Minimal's type position. Well, so once again, we can play the same tropical games, so we can enumerate tropical solutions with Bloch-Gershon multiplicities, and this time we will get, so in degree 3 and genus 0, we will get, instead of q to minus 1 plus 10 plus q, we will get q to minus 1 plus 7. But we will get some slightly modified Bloch-Gershon polynomial. So this is in the rational case. So what do we do in the case of positive genus? For example, in the elliptic case, which will be of the main interest for us at the end. Well, I can push 3d minus 1 points to the axis. So they will create one extra point on the boundary. So I will have 3d points on the boundary, but I still have some point in R2 because in the elliptic problem, the number of points is 3d minus 1 plus g. So g is equal to 1, so it's 3d. So I have some extra point remaining in R2. I cannot push this point to the boundary because I will, if I do it, I degenerate my curves. So I'll keep this last point in the tropical dots. And another modification I'd like to make. So I'd like to allow my curve to intersect to be tangent to coordinate axis, and probably with high order of tangents. So meaning that for points that are on the tropical boundary, finite, referring to toric devices, for each of these points, I prescribe the order of intersection of the curves I am interested in at this point with the corresponding axis. And when I speak about the order of intersection, so I'd like really my curve to be unibranched at this point. So I refer the order of tangents. And so here is an example of such a situation in the elliptic case. So at infinity now, we have 3 points on one axis, 2 points on the vertical axis, and 2 points on the horizontal axis. And for example, for the vertical axis, one of the points has this number 2, meaning that I'd like to have a simple tangency at this point. I'd like to have a tangency, and the order of intersection should be 2. In the tropical language, it means that the ray going to infinity and reaching this point should have the weight. Okay, so I think it's clear what is shift of settings, that shift of setting in our iterative problem. So now we are ready to move to the second pattern to speak about Grishin-Halkin's refinement in the case of real rational curves. So what we will do now, we will enumerate real curves. So you can tell me, keeping this interactive, that already R appeared in my description. But remember that R2 in the previous description, so this tropical setting, was the tropical analog of C star squared. So we were in fact secretly enumerating complex curves. When we enumerate complex curves, we can also enumerate real curves if the constraints are real. But what we will do now, we will just enumerate real curves. We'll forget for a moment about complex curves. And we will enumerate what is called separating real curves. So what is separating real curves? Sometimes they're called real curves of type 1. So this is a terminology proposed by Klein. So Klein divided the real curves in two types, type 1 and type 2. So what is type 1? So what is a separating real curve? So if our curve is not singular, so we have a Riemann surface equipped with an anti-holomorphic involution, and the fixed point set of this involution, so the real point set of our curve. So there are two options for this real point set. It can happen that the real point set divides the complex point set in two halves, exchanged by the complex conjugation, or it can happen that the complement of the real point set is connected. So separating means that we have two halves. And these are exactly the curves I'd like to consider. So now let me recall you the notion of inverse of algebraic curves. So now this, in principle, this notion, of course, is used in the case of complex curves in sista squared. We will be interested in real curves, but for amoebas, it's for the definition of amoeba, it doesn't matter. So we just consider the image of our curve under this logarithmic map. So this logarithmic map already appeared today in Grisha's talk. So we just take coordinate-wise logarithm of absolute value. And so we consider a curve in sista squared, an algebraic curve in sista squared, and we consider the image of this curve under this logarithmic map. So if you start with a line, you will get such a picture. I tried to draw without great success, but not can imagine what is it. And so if our curve is real and separating, what I can do, I can consider one of two halves of this curve and consider this, I wrote signed area of its amoeba, but it's probably better to say weighted area of its amoeba. Because so we consider the logarithmic image of this half. And since I have chosen one half of a complex curve, this half has already an orientation. Thus, we have an orientation on the boundary of this half, other words, on the real part of our curve. So when we consider this logarithmic image, so if we consider the logarithmic image of the real part, so we have orientations of this logarithmic image. So for each point of the complement, you can consider the index of your point with respect to this oriented image of the real part. So just use this index as weight and calculate the weighted area. So of course, if you play this game with the whole curve, not with the half. So first of all, you should say what are the orientations to consider. So you can, if you change the choice of half, so you switch all the orientations, you will get minus the area you got in the first calculation. So the sum is zero. But I do this calculation for each half separately. And here is a theorem proved by Grisha Mihalkin. So, which is really very surprising. So assume that we are playing with a real curve, which is separating. So this is a curve of degree d in the complex projective plane. And I assume that this curve intersects the toric devices, the coordinate axis of P2, only in real points. And then I can consider the part of my curve living in sista squared, consider this sign. So I take it half of my curve. I consider this signed area, signed logarithmic area of the chosen half. And the statement is that it's always of the form k is square, or where, well, what is important, the k is a half integer. So in particular, when you move your curve, provided that all the intersection points with the coordinate axis remain real, you don't change this signed logarithmic area. And well, in addition, this k is between minus d squared over 2 and d squared over 2. And so this number k you associate to, not really to a real separating curve, you associate this k to a half of such a curve. Because if you switch, if you change your choice of the half, you multiply k by minus one. So this number k is what Grisha called quantum index of the half. And now we will enumerate, you see, to get some kind of block-Gaussian polynomial, one should introduce some additional parameter in the enumeration. And this is this quantum index will be used to introduce one additional parameter. So we will do the following. So we'll enumerate curves, and I'd like to enumerate only real curves, only separating real curves, and only separating real curves intersecting the coordinate axis at real points. So if I would take my points in the complement of the coordinate axis, it would be extremely difficult for me when I start to move points to certify that the curves I'm interested in still satisfy all these conditions. So what can I do? So first of all, to make sure that my curves are separating, I will enumerate just rational curves. And since each of these curves will have a one-dimensional real part, because my curves should pass through some real points, I will have necessarily two halves of my sphere. So all the curves will be automatically separating because they're rational. And now to make sure that all the intersections with the coordinate axis are real, I will choose points on the coordinate axis. That's why I wanted to change our enumerative problem. And for some additional reasons, I will consider the following problem. So in fact, I will fix on each of the three coordinate axes, I will fix D points, but I will enumerate curves of degree 2D. So what I'd like my curves, so each of my curves, to be a simple tangent at each chosen point to the corresponding coordinate axis. And I'd like to enumerate real rational curves, and the curves, to make my enumeration reasonable, I will choose all the points, in fact, on the boundary of the positive quadrant. So this is my choice. Okay, so now I will enumerate this curves, but now since we have this notion of quantum index, I will do this enumeration separately for each possible value of the quantum index. And so this is the second theorem proved by Grisha concerning this quantum indices. So this real rational half curves, so half because I need to speak about the quantum index, so I will enumerate half curves and not curves, and sine, so as in the case of invariance, to get an invariant in the real world, one should enumerate real curves with appropriate signs. And so let me recall that in the case of Fils-Rangé, the sign was determined by the parity of the number of elliptic real nodes of our curve. So here, for this enumeration, one should to determine the sign of the curve, one should count the number of elliptic nodes only in the first quadrant. So we count the number of real elliptic nodes of our curve in the first quadrant. If this number is even, then the sign is plus. If this number is odd, then the sign is minus. And then, in fact, there is one additional twist, so one additional renormalization for each quantum index, but I will not go into details. So the same number of real rational half curves of degree 2D and of given quantum index k, so my curves should be simply tangent to the axis at the chosen points. So these points are on the boundary of the positive quadrant. So this same number does not depend on the choice of the configuration of points. So it gives you an invariant. And moreover, if you cook up a generating function, so you write the generation generating function for this invariance using k, so the quantum index as power of q, then the result up to this factor q to 1/2 minus q to minus 1/2 to the power 3d minus 2, this generating function coincides with the corresponding block Gaussian polynomial. And notice that, well, this factor looks strange, but it's just the common denominator of this multiplicities appearing in block Gaussian enumeration. So q to 1/2 minus q to minus 1/2 is the denominator, and 3d minus 2 is the number of trivial vertices of our rational group. So, in other words, this generating function is just the numerator of appearing in this block Gaussian enumeration. In particular, what is really surprising in this story, it means that enumerating these real curves according to quantum indices, I can get the number of complex solutions to our problem, right? Because since I obtained this generating function just counting real curves, but according to the quantum indices, now I get the generating function, I divide by this this factor, and I get the block Gaussian polynomial. So after the division, I can plug q equal to 1, and this will be the number of complex solutions. And so, in fact, the proof of, I hope I will have a couple of minutes to say some words about the proof of the second part of the theorem. In fact, the proof is tropical. So you go to the tropical limit, you calculate this invariance in the tropical limit. And once you do it, so once you prove that this invariance can be calculated in the tropical limit, in the tropical limit, you can really calculate them. So there is a Caparaza-Harris type recursive formula for this invariance. And this formula was proved by Thomas Blom. So now let me move to the elliptic case. So as I said, it's our joint work with Zhenya Shustin. And what we wanted to do with Zhenya, we wanted to extend a little bit this framework of refinement of enumeration of real curves made by Grisha in the rational case. So to understand what happens and why, how it can be explained, how it can be understood that we get this block Gaussian polynomial. So we wanted to vary some parameters. In particular, we wanted to vary the genus. So we decided to see what happens in the elliptic case. So in the elliptic case, there are several problems, and one of them is that even I fix, if I fix 3D points on the boundary, and one point on the auditory devices, and one point outside of the auditory devices. So if I fix all the points of the boundary real, this will of course guarantee that for all the curves in our enumeration, all the intersection points with the toric devices will be real. But in the elliptic case, it's more difficult to guarantee that all my real curves will be separating. So of course, I can just say that I'm interested only in separating real curves. But in this way, I will not get an invariant for sure, because when I move my points, what will happen is that my elliptic curves will, even if I had in my initial collection only separating curves, and I considered only separating curves, when I start to move points, curves move, and it can happen that separating elliptic curve So meaning that my elliptic curve, so the real part of this curve has two connected components. So this components can glue and then form one connected component, and this curve will not be separated. So in order to guarantee that all the curves are interested in separating, let's do the following trick. Let's once again take 3D points on the boundary of the positive quadrant. So each of this, so each of the axes containing D points, I will be still interested in curves of degree 2D, simply tangent to the axis at this point. And then I will choose my extra point. I still have one point. I have one point to choose. Let's choose this point in a quadrant, in a different quadrant, not in the positive one. And thus, my each elliptic curve in my collection will have at least, and thus exactly, two connected components of the real path. So one connected component will live in the positive quadrant, and one connected component I will have to have in this additional quadrant where I have chosen an extra point. So my curve will be necessarily separating. So I can play Grisha's game. I can consider the quantum index. And so here is the statement we proved with Jean-Justin. So the signed number of here, the sign is determined by the parity of real elliptic nodes in the positive quadrant, plus the parity of hyperbolic real nodes in the outside of the positive quadrant, so in this second quadrant where the extra point lives. And once again, there is some normalization, this common normalization for each quantum index. So the same number of real elliptic half curves in degree D. So the statement is very similar to Grisha's statement. This same number is again invariant, which is slightly surprising because, for example, in the Vilsonger situation, if one uses Vilsonger science to enumerate elliptic curves in general, one doesn't have an invariant. But here it's an invariant. In addition, for each quantum index, it's an invariant. And one can calculate this invariant in the tropical world. And so my description was in the case of the plane, but it works also for some other toric surfaces. So that's some restrictions, but it works for many toric surfaces. And in fact, you can, if you want, also increase the orders of intersection with axes. So you, instead of fixing the order two everywhere, you can consider other even orders. And one can calculate this invariance in the tropical world. So let me just give you one example. So I will not write down the tropical formula for this invariance, but let me describe the tropical multiplicity, refined tropical multiplicity to consider in one case. So just to explain what happens here, probably to say a couple of words about the proof, that the correspondent theorem I formulated, so it was not so Grisha's correspondent theorem, it was a slightly different framework, but in this shifted framework, it works exactly in the same way, so it's exactly the same theorem by Grisha. But this theorem can be refined, meaning that since, as I said, it's not an equality of numbers, it's kind of a projection. In Grisha's statement, one can take into account, if we are speaking about real curve, the type of the curve, the quantum index, and the distribution of solitary, so elliptic and non-solitary hyperbolic nodes among the quadrants. So all these quantities can be traced in Grisha's correspondent theorem. So let's consider an example of a tropical elliptic curve. So you have this cycle in yellow, You can see the dual subdivisions. The dual subdivision is formed by triangles and parallelograms because my curve is nodal. So each vertex is either trivalent or four-valent, and the four-valent vertex is dual to a parallelogram necessarily because it should be kind of cross. And what happens in the proof of the correspondence theorem is that when you look at a tropical curve and you want to glue a complex solution to our enumerative problem out of this tropical curve, what you do, you use for each triangle of dual subdivision, or you prefer for each trivalent vertex of our tropical curve, you can see the rational curve, which has this triangle as a Newton polygon, and which is maximally tangent to each toric divisor at one point. And then out of this rational curves, you glue your complex solution. If you want to glue a real solution, you glue real rational curves. If you want to trace the type, you can, one or two, you can do it. And in the case of type one, in the case of separating curves, if you want to trace one half, so if you want to glue one half of your curve, you glue halves of this real rational curves. So each half will contribute to the quantum index plus or minus one, the latest, the Euclidean area of the corresponding triangle. And so since I can choose either one half or the other half, I will have in this global configuration of quantum index, I will have either the Euclidean area of this triangle or minus the Euclidean area of this triangle. And in the case where all the triangles are even, so an even triangle for me, the triangle such that all the adjacent edges are of even weight. This is the case if you enumerate rational curves. So if all the triangles are even, for each triangle I can choose one half of the corresponding real rational curve independently on the choices made for other triangles. That's why in the calculation you have the product of factors, each of factors being of the form Q to the area, Euclidean area of the triangle, plus minus u to minus this Euclidean area. And in fact, this adjustment of signs for each quantum index is made in such a way that it's always minus. That's why you have the product of numerators in block Deutsch expressions in Grisha's problem. In the elliptic case, the situation is a little bit different because, so here on my picture, you can see two even triangles, so corresponding to this two green vertices. You can see one parallelogram, which is dual to the intersection point, this intersection point in white. Dual to this intersection point. And you have some number of odd triangles. So odd meaning not even. So at least one edge, in fact, exactly two edges are of odd width. And these triangles, in fact, should be separated in two groups, surprisingly. So the blue group and the red group. So the blue, these are triangles, odd triangles which are dual to vertices adjacent to rays, like my blue ray, rays of my tropical curve, orthogonal to the side separating the positive quadrant and the extra quadrant where I have chosen point. So there's some additional extra special quadrant. And if I have a ray orthogonal to this side, the vertex adjacent to this ray, if this vertex is odd, is special. So I color this vertex in this blue color. And if not, I color my odd vertex in red color. And so what I'm saying is that the tropical multiplicity of this curve, tropical refined multiplicity, is like this. So first of all, for each green triangle, as in the rational case, you have the corresponding factor, Q to the Euclidean area minus Q minus Euclidean area. For each blue odd triangle, you also have a similar factor. Like these triangles, in a sense, behave as even triangles. But for red triangles, I don't have individual factors. I have just one factor for all of them. And this is because when I want to, for one of these triangles, I want to switch the choice of one half of the real rational curve in this triangle, I have to switch my choice in all these red triangles. So the corresponding edges are odd, and the choices of halves are no more independent as in the even case. So there is some frozen part of the cycle which can be reversed only simultaneously. And so it gives rise to some factor, some red factor. And now it's no more true that the sign between these two powers of Q is necessarily minus. It can be plus, as in this example. And moreover, there is some sign which appears for this whole expression. So in this my example, there is the sign minus, actually. Take out. But there is some combinatorial rule to associate tropical multiplicities, it's refined tropical multiplicities to tropical solutions to our innovative problem. And the claim is that it's a claim, it's in fact an immediate corollary of this refinement for the correspondence theorem, so of Grishin correspondence theorem, in that if I enumerate my tropical elliptic solutions with this refined tropical multiplicities, I will get this refined enumeration of real elliptic curves. So I will get this this invariance. So just two remarks and two questions to finish. So first of all, there are two new interesting phenomena in this story. First of all, the refined tropical multiplicity I just described is no more localized at vertices. Right? So previous tropical multiplicities were always products of something at vertices. So here it's no more the case. So there is this red factor, which is in a sense global. And the second strange remark that, of course, we have, so if you enumerate curves, our tropical curves with this tropical, refined tropical multiplicities, we'll get tropical invariant. But this tropical invariant is not local in the following sense. So if you move in the space of configuration of points, so you should study what happens when you go across a wall. And what I'm saying is that here for this problem, when you go across some walls, to see the invariance, you should take into account several events happening at the same time. So it's no more localized at given single tropical curve. So you should see what happens at two different places. And so my time is over, so let me just finish by the following two questions. So I think speaking about unifying unifications, so it would be really interesting and important to try to unify various interpretations of refined invariance, at least the interpretations I mentioned. And another interesting question, in my opinion, is to try to find relations between this refined real invariance I described, and other types of refined tropical invariance, because in tropical world there are various possible refinements. So there is a refinement proposed, for example, by Goetsch and Schroeter, so for what is called broccoli tropical curves. So it would be really interesting to understand what are the relations between all these refinements, what are the structures which are still hidden and we don't see, but probably we just see some various appearances of something which is hidden. Thank you for your attention.